Back to Pulse's question. So there's a couple of things. They all really revolve around this redemption issue and some education that goes into this. So this is all one big conversation. So the short answer is here's kind of the magic that we have going on, right? So what we have and what you've seen with the increase in like TCR as a whole is PulseChain is very, very volatile. And as its price increases, it naturally moves everyone's ICR, right? So if you're at 300%, don't tell me you guys are brokenhearted. We'll get you guys drinking like adults. Don't worry. So if you tell me you're at 300% and Pulse doubles, there you go. You're no longer at 300% until you remit. So what we've had recently is a really big combination of things. So the one that's sort of on us, the team that we're trying to tighten up, is this arbitrage window. So to keep it really simple, there's a 15-minute lag inside of liquid loans, and it's designed to help price spikes, scam wicks, all the kind of things that people would naturally about, all the whale games, liquidity pool manipulation, these things that can cause liquidations, right? Violent kind of price spikes up and down. And whenever you're using something like Fetch, it's a decentralized oracle, you need to have time for validation, right? So you could think of things like block confirmations or similar. You basically have time to validate that price is correct. So this works fantastic on robustness around the price speed itself and protection around liquidations. But what it has done is basically caused the difference in what the LL DApp sees and what spot price is. And that's what's opened up this arbitrage opportunity. So what we've done so far is basically we completely minimized what we had as a TWAP that was on top of that and used just down to a volume weighted, which means we're taking the PLS price from multiple pools and trying to and smoothing out that way to make sure that price is as accurate as possible. Now, the 15 minutes is still too heavy. We're still seeing too many redemptions overall for what we'd like to see. So the shorter answer is everything in LL is working exactly as it's supposed to. Everything in Fetch is working exactly as it's supposed to. But this overlap here in this pricing is what's giving that opportunity for the ARBs. So that ARB is what's caused this kind of oral redemptions. And I'm sure we'll get some extra questions here and we'll work through some of the specifics. But essentially is that overlap there, that area in the middle, is causing an ARB. So what we keep seeing is as price moves up, we see a few redemptions and it bumps everyone's ICR up just a little more. And then no one wants to come back down. So assuming that we add a little less ARBs, a little more kind of an experienced user base. Again, this isn't blaming you, just talking overall, all these different factors. People would move back down pretty aggressively. So the same issues we have for redemptions at 600%, everyone could move back down to 200%. And it would be the same. It wouldn't change the amount of redemptions. But essentially, we're just kind of teetering up. And you see this move back down in price. Then we move back up. And then we teeter down in price. So this is what's kind of caused the TCR of the entire system to be relatively high. You see this sometimes with liquidity as well. So we're going through all these things and smoothing out that time. We're hoping that we're going to have that update out before the end of the month, maybe a little quicker, but you know how dev is. So once we get through there, that aspect of being able to tighten that time window, and then also add a little extra liquidity, everyone should be trying to find some liquidity to add for USDL to help with the spikes that you see on there. So those two things are what will help smooth out the redemptions. And that will help bring down that TCR, and then it'll naturally open the vaults back up. So one, people who, if they don't want to be as active, aren't as familiar, aren't as savvy DeFi users, they don't want to have to manage the vaults up that high, right? So you see some people like, hey, I want to be hands off, I'm not dealing with it. You see some people just don't have the weight to draw in, right? Like we're at a 500%, you got to have, you know, around $10,000 in PLS. So all these things will naturally, as we pull that back down, as there's redemption issue gets tightened up, you'll see that people have to be less hands-on for vaults, that TCR moves down. So people don't feel like they have to have such a massive amount to get started. So essentially, it's kind of what we would kind of think naturally. We'll smooth all those things out. We'll see an increase in user base. These vaults will open back up. We'll open ourselves up to more people who want to open a vault but just don't feel comfortable to yet. And then from there, it's just more marketing. And as we see the PLS price rise up, we'll see even more users who can use it. We'll see bigger loans. We'll see bigger yields. Everything basically moves up in tandem from there, and we'll get to rocking. So most people, if they're managing this pretty hands-on, they can still see a pretty big gain. Where most people who are pretty upset have really had an issue, it's when they get redeemed early and they haven't spent enough time to sort of realize, okay, this is how I need to open my vault. Here's where the gains are. Spend some time. So like, if you've had a vault open since the beginning, you've been collecting yield, you've had increased exposure to PLS. And if you get caught with a redemption for a couple of, you know, a couple of grand or whatever reason, whatever level you're at there, you just take some time, you buy back in. It's not the end of the world. But if you open up the day up and you get redeemed, and then you're like, what's going on? Where's my PLS? That's where the issue is. So as we lower this back down, it's going to kind of increase that threshold of safety for newer users. And again, we'll see these metrics kind of trail up. So that's a big positive there.
Typically, when we see those big fluctuations in USDL, it's when people are moving in weight and not using Piteas. So if you look through, especially the liquidity on USDL, one of the things that's really unique about the FUX platform is the multi-asset pools, especially with stable coins, makes for exceptional order execution. So when you go through and look at how much value you can run through on Piteas, you'll see that it's heavily weighted toward the FUX pools, especially if you're using USDL, because again, that when you have four stable coins all together, they naturally want to hold each other together. Kind of like Hart's Law, but it's all together. So because they all have individual mechanics and different ARBs separate from other places, they'll try to hold each other together. So that FUX pool does an amazing job for USDL. But if people go through and try to make big orders with USDL outside of it, especially in like the USDL PLS pool, you'll see that big spike. So when a lot of us use like Dex Screener, when you're looking at Dex Screener for information on loan or USDL or most assets, it's really just going to pull from one pool, right? So that's not all the price action that you'll see in every pool. It's the exact pool you're looking at. So you can see, like, you can pull up like USDL loan and PLS loan, and you'll see that USDL loan sometimes will open up an R if there's less liquidity there. PLS loan has more liquidity. You'll see that USDL PLS has, I don't know, 700K or something like that, that you'll see on Dex Screener, but it's also paired on FUX for about a million, 2 million, 3 million, four, somewhere in there the last time I looked. So when you go through and look at like order execution, it's really important, especially on big orders, to use something like Piteas, especially on PLS, anything outside of PLS where it doesn't have these like massive liquidity bonds. We don't really have that problem too much on ETH, but it's really important on PLS to make sure that you're going through there and getting good order execution. For one, this is important for two reasons. One, for things like that where you get spikes or these small things. But like, if you guys have been paying attention on the chart and you see these big, huge candles where someone doesn't market order sell, there's a lot to learn from that, man. So if you see someone who makes a 600K market sell and you see that they slip 10% and they swap inside of MetaMask, so they take whatever it is, another 1% or 0.5% fee or whatever it is, that person ate that on the way out. And maybe, you know, a lot of people, especially if this is your first like big bull cycle, if you came in 21, 22, missed the last run up, you know, you may have not actually had to move around big weight in crypto yet. And you should look, please listen and learn from this. Those are huge opportunities, man. Like, if you look at what those guys lose in slippage and on order execution or swip inside of PLS or any of these things, like that's your money, right? Like if you think that you're going to get a, let's call it a 15X. If you think you're going to 15X your bag, then that means that if you can save, say, 10% slippage or any of those things on the high side, like you're seeing with these players, that means that just by learning how to do proper order execution, you would make more money than you have in your bags right now. If you think you're going to 10X your bags from right now, then learning how to use Piteas, break it up, use V3, limit orders, any of these things are a combination of all three, will literally earn you more than your entire bag is. Like, that's how important that stuff is. So I know it's not always sexy to sit here and go, hey, learn how to sell on the way out. It's so much easier just to point at charts, talk about timing, X, Y, Z. But order execution is a big deal, especially as you start to catch some of these X's and need to learn a way to get out. Big, big deal. So USDL PLS pays out really well. I think a big part of that is just making sure that people are aware of it. It pays out healthy, especially if you looked at, say, like the last 24 hours. Anytime you start to see the volume approach the size or exceed the size of the LP pool, you're looking at getting paid out pretty heavily, especially if one side is a stable coin. You don't have, it dampens that impermanent loss risk there. So one, I think honestly, just a bit of education there. And then naturally USDL, as the market starts to cool off, you'll see more and more people want to provide liquidity there. Because whenever you think the market's super hot, you want to be risk on. And so risk on just means you want exposure to the price, right? So like USDL, like every dollar you hold in stables is like a dollar you don't hold in something that can appreciate. So one, people just need to look at the yield. It's very healthy on that pair. But as far as for stabilizing USDL, the FUX pool is way stronger. Last I looked at it, it's around like 20%. So again, 20% versus wanting exposure to the market. Most people will take exposure to the market right now, but it's going to give you a great place to either like say hold dry powder. It's going to give you a great place to, as you start to want to take profit, man, getting paid 20%+ on stables is massive. And we'll see some really interesting stuff play out with that as well when we see the convex layer that Fast and Yellowcake are working on. It's going to be called 2FUX. I don't make up the names, guys. I'm just here telling y'all what it is. But it's a convex layer that will also help push some of the reward as far as the gauging of the pools and FUX. So gets a little into the weeds there, but essentially it'll just add extra value to what we have going on the pools there. And USDL loan. That's one I think lots of people should be in. But again, it's kind of the same thing. Do you really want to hold the USDL side too much on that pair? Most people would probably prefer that it gets bonded heavily with PLS, allows it to move up in tandem, and then you get price exposure to both sides. So the short answer is we just need to explain more about what the value side is for particular players who are wanting to take some of the yield. And then on USDL loan, we'll see. Most people would probably want to do PLS in loan. And then also there's a gauge pool for loan that has almost, there's a ton of value. I think it's paying out triple digit APR. The loan pool that's, I think it's 60% loan, 10% PLS, 30% USDL. So it's a multi-asset pool on FUX. That's a beautiful pool. It's fantastic. When it comes to randomness, this gets a little meta. When it gets to randomness, the idea that you have a set of parameters that give you a random number kind of makes it not random by nature. Now again, is it random enough, right? So like the idea is, you know, if you have all the, you know, all the mining power in the world, you can guess every single block, but it's like, but is it random enough, you know, with SHA-256? So there's imperfect uses of RNGs that are available on chain. It's something we've gone back and forth with on having the RNG available on fetch. I don't think it's going to be available right off the bat when we go public with it here in the next, you know, few months or so. But RNGs can be really tricky. So when they're used for, again, it's like a threshold, right? So if you say that there's an RNG because me and you want to flip a coin to see, you know, I don't know, whatever it is, right? Me and you, we're going to bet $10. Are you going to go through the amount of effort it would take to de-randomize and rig or give yourself any kind of a slant on $10? No. But if you're running an RNG that, say, is involved in a protocol where there could be 7-8 figures that's sort of on the hook for how random that is, okay, now you're going to find how crazy people will go through to sort of sort that out. So there is issues about doing RNG on chain, and everyone just kind of has to understand that, like, how important it is and sort of at what threshold there is for exploitation around that. No one else is offering it right this second that I'm aware of. But I think it is something that we will get to eventually in time with Fetch. There's the Jacob, who I'm a fan of over at PulsePot. I think the Win-Win guys, there's a handful of different protocols that need RNG for a handful of different things they're doing. I know some of the NFT guys do as well. So that's something that we're going to keep trying to make sure that we're available on to work through for you know, other teams to make sure it's available. It's not something that we particularly need, but we do want to make sure that every team has everything possible that they can do on PulseChain to keep doing some damage. So PulseX is a Uniswap V2 fork. So that's what Uniswap is on, essentially on PulseChain. Same code you're used to. FUX is a copy of what's called Balancer. And they both have different, there's different pros and cons there. So V2 works really, really nice for price action. It's built by RH. It'll apply a portion of the transaction fees go to PulseX. So if you're a PulseX holder, if you say, I want to be more, RH maxi, he's the guy I trust. I want to stay in my lane, do exactly what I know. All those things will lend you toward PulseX. Where Flux is especially strong is the multi-asset pools using things like Balancer. So it's really massive. It's really a big deal for things like USDL and keeping pegs. It's incredible for that. But as far as for an individual user on the gain side, there's something called Hocus Pocus. Those guys are pretty cool. Again, anytime I bring another platform, guys, I'm talking about my own experience. You guys got to vet them, look at audits, take your time. Don't just go click stuff because WaLLrus brought them up one time. Take your time to vet these things. I'm just bringing up some of the resources. So Hocus Pocus has a sort of, and they actually even call it a wizard. It goes along with their theme. But it's a kind of liquidity front end that you can look through a lot of options to see like where it is you can get the best value for certain tokens. So the short answer is it depends on what you're doing, but you should look at all these, right? So like if you're holding, especially stables, the Flux is going to be awesome. For other pools, you really want to look and see if there's something incentivized. So a gauge pool, farms on PLSX, or 9mm again has incentivized pools. Same thing with 9-inch and some of the meme stuff. So like if you have certain meme tokens, you probably want to be on those farms. It's going to outweigh the actual liquidity fees. And then for, again, users on the outside, to kind of go along with the same kind of topic here, we want someone like Pineapple Love to do what's in their best interest. Go find the place where you're going to make the most yield for your liquidity. Now, what we want to do as users to make sure that everyone else is incentivized to provide liquidity is to use things that are like DEX aggregators. So again, if you just simply want to push the buy and burn, go hit PulseX. That's what it's there for. If that's your big bag, if you're RH only, all the means, just hit PulseX. That's the way to maximize your impact on the buy and burn. But if you just want fantastic order execution, if you want to incentivize liquidity providers to kind of go chase their own yield, then Piteas crushes it. You're going to get fantastic order execution and it basically incentivize other liquidity providers to just go find where their best yield is. And then you're going to go find them using the DEX aggregator. When it comes to the USDL style pools that have a bunch of stables, there's always a bit of contract risk. So like the first thing is you have to trust the platform and the pool you're in, right? So like that's kind of a given with anything, right? So what's the risk of being in LL? You got to trust LL. What's the risk of being on Flux or 9mm or any of these platforms? You have to trust the contracts themselves. But as far as for the pools themselves, when it comes to the stable on stable pools, there's really not too much of impermanent risk loss. The swan event is that one breaks. So you have like the big stablecoin pool with USDL is USDL, USDC, USDT, and DAI. So if USDC blacklisted it, you're going to end up with a heavy distribution of that. So when it comes to the stablecoins, the risk is that something breaks and then you end up with the bad one. That's the kind of really high-end risk. The more realistic risk is that your yield is not as valuable as what you would get from being price or risk on, right? So if I hold 10 grand in stables making 20%, if I could have held PLS and it goes up 50X, well, okay, then essentially it was the opportunity cost. So that's the big one on stables is just how much of your portfolio do you want to allocate to being risk on, being on an asset that can go up and down, PulseX, Inc., Teddy, Loan, whatever it is, right? So all these different kinds of things. And then when it comes to say like PLS and Loan, like that pair, it's that they don't move in tandem together. So if you see PLS skyrocket or you see Loan skyrocket and move, you'll end up with something called impermanent loss. And essentially what it means is that what you got incentivized with did not cover the amount of loss that you had in the movement of the coins versus having just held the coins themselves. So you can have impermanent loss and still be up. So you could hold those hold something like PLS and Loan. They move around a whole bunch. You say make 3 grand in liquidity fees and your bag that was worth 40K is now worth 50K. So now you've got 53K worth. You started at 40. The impermanent loss would factor in is if you had held Loan in PLS and they move up and say you'd have 56,000, you're still in a positive. You still made a bunch because you still had exposure to them and you made the liquidity fees. But your impermanent loss is that 3K, the difference that you would have held. So that's the big risk on being a liquidity provider is just that essentially the difference in movement there is greater than whatever it is you got paid out to provide liquidity in. So the idea is if you want something to be valuable, then you got to have more value on it, right? That's the idea of like TVL you see pretty routinely. So if you imagine, I'm going to explain the bridge like we see with pulse rent real quickly. So if you have a poker table, there's five people playing at it, and you say, hey, I want to go play too. And you walk up to one of the players and you say, hey, here's $100. Give me $100 worth of chips. He says, okay. The value on the table hasn't changed. You actually haven't brought value to the network. All that we've done is change the ownership of the value on the network. And that's how what you're referring to there is, which is like a cross-chain swap or a DEX aggregator, cross-chain DEX aggregator. What you see with what's called like a lock and mint, like pulse rent, where you see wrapped USDC, wrapped Bitcoins, all these things, is they actually move value on. And that's like going to the cage at the casino. So if I take $100 and go to the cage and say, hey, give me 100 more chips, what I've done is these chips are just plastic, but they represent my $100. That's a wrap. A poker chip is a wrap token, okay? And I take that, now I go back to that same poker table. Now there's 100 more dollars on there. So that's why it's important to have like a lock and mint style bridge early on before you have more traditional fiat on ramps. And again, get a little meta with it, but that's the reason that those things are important, is to be able to add value to the network and sort of get things bootstrapped and get some kind of accepted value from other places and stable coins. But now there's, like PortalX. I'm working with the guys over at Houdini Swap actually to add some privacy. That would be really, really cool. They do it through central exchanges. So we're going to have to talk with those guys more and work out some of where the liquidity is at. But they're a really cool team. So shout out to Aaron over at Houdini Swap. They're actually already now supporting PulseChain. We just basically need to go through and get some liquidity that's available to make sure that we can actually get some order execution. So it probably won't be available on PulseX, but lots of teams are working on that cross-chain kind of compatibility stuff. A lot of cool stuff there. Man, there are a couple of good things. One, testnet, and the next four answers are also testnet. Go through and check all these things out, right? It's important to just not have sweaty palms when you go through and start clicking on things. Whenever I go to help most people, our dApp is very intuitive. So you can go on the dApp, look at the explainer videos, you can click the tour and walk through. We have just an absolute avalanche of blog and video content, whatever. So whatever it is that you feel like you learn the best from, we have that stuff everywhere. We have the LL Librarian, which is our AI assistant. It's right there on the website. So if you pull up the standard liquidloans.io, go to the bottom right corner, click the LL Librarian, you can ask her like, hey, who's WaLLrus? What are redemptions? How does this work? What's liquidation fees? How do I click this button? All that kind of stuff. So we have a lot of resources there. So I would say to go to the median that you like the best. So the start here page that we have on the website as well, start here and just content and content and content, and then work through whatever it is you want to do on the testnet and see where you stumble. Like, hey, okay, I did everything, but then I, didn't understand the claim button on stability pool. Hey, I sat here and I was looking at my vault stats and I didn't really get this. All right, perfect. Now we can direct you towards something more specific. So go to the meeting you like best. We have tons of blogs. Our writers are fantastic. They spend a lot of time on it. There's, again, mountains of video content. So start with whatever platform, again, whatever medium works best for you, but the start here page, the blog, the YouTube, and then come to the Telegram and obviously ask specific questions. Yep. Loan earns yield every day. And the other thing about loans yield, I bring this up a few times, but I think it's very underappreciated, especially again, if you have kind of a hex-centric worldview. Most tokens that have a yield pay out in the token, which means that the price of that token is reflective and also of your yield. The loan's different because loan pays out in USDL and PLS. So one is, if you're just holding and scraping yield, you don't particularly care what the price of loan does between now and then until it's time to actually go sell that loan. Now, again, I've seen the loan chart. It's rough. I know this is not cope. Just calling a spade and realizing how to maximize the value out of that loan along the way. So with loan, any value that you get in PLS, so let's say that you're getting paid out at roughly a 20% APR in just PLS. If loan doubles, then you got a 40% yield. So that loan, that yield is not only not subject to the loan price, but it is subject to the PLS price. So loan can do what it does, and you can just keep taking that yield. The loan price basically just reflects a cost of that pool share. So that yield there, again, or the bean or these other things, you don't really care what the price of loan does until it's time to sell. So that's one of those things that changes the bit of the calculus when you're looking at how you want to allocate things, that you don't necessarily have to be too overly concerned with the price of the loan while you're just using it as like a loan yield bearing instrument. So that's one big side of both things. That's not something that we're likely to build on the front end. There is a vault alarm bot that's kind of cool. The Up guys built that, Haunted and that team over there, that gives you some thresholds. You can also set some pricing thresholds, which will help you get a bit of a bearing on it. But the most important thing is that we work on like what I was talking about at the very beginning of the stream, that we lower that opportunity for arbitrage there, and that we just reduce the amount of redemptions overall. And as you see that, you'll see people move back down kind of in line. So again, some of this disparity here isn't just that redemptions are high, it's that redemptions being high have stopped people from ebbing back down. So if the aggressive players who are getting the most out of the system, who have the highest yield, are down at 150, 200, blah, 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 blah. The people who are want to be more hands off, who don't want to touch this, if they're at 300 to 500 or 600, they never get bothered. Who cares, right? You don't have to have the same level of concern. And you kind of let the aggressive players, I'm very relatively aggressive. I stay on that edge. I've been redeemed a handful of times. I think five times I've been clipped along the way. You kind of allow us to sort of manage the things that are more difficult. And again, as we move it down, that'll allow that cushion that we're sort of in now will actually be the more hands-off players, and they'll be less difficult to manage. So I think a handful of things will make this simpler. One, there'll just be more third-party stuff like the loan alarm vault and cool things that come out and help. You'll see that ICR slide back down as we lower redemptions. The redemptions themselves will be lowered, and that again will kind of open up that space again for more hands-off users, I guess would make sense. Piteas is a DEX aggregator. So what it's going to do is try to make sure that for X in, you get the highest Y out. So PortalX, if I'm remembering correctly, I'll have to have LV and Jesse and all those boys double check me. It's going to go from one pool to aggregate across the bridge and double check another spot. So it's still just one pool on each side. So a single pairing essentially. Piteas will spread it across multiple pairings. So if you want to check that out, you can go, like if you go into PulseX, you can look at the auto router, and you can, when you type in a certain amount, if you type in a higher amount, you'll watch it, that it'll start to spread across pools, but it can only spread across pools that are inside of PulseX. If you look at Piteas and you go to the route, you'll see that it spreads across everything. Even some of the Uniswap front ends that we don't really have any user front end, they can still access it on the contract side. So you'll see that it spreads between 9mm and Fox and PulseX and 9-inch and the Uniswap front ends. It's going to try to collect the most amount. So in general, especially the larger amount you go to, Piteas is always going to have the best order execution. Remember, it's not a DEX, it's an aggregator. It doesn't hold that liquidity, it's accessing that liquidity across the entire chain. So you're naturally going to see that it has the best order execution. So one super cool thing about internet money, besides that they're huge supporters of PulseChain, they're a native wallet, that KG and Don do all kinds of cool stuff for the community. They always have. They've been very stand up. The internet money wallet also has that DEX aggregator, like similar to Piteas that I've been talking about, that goes through and routes between. So if you go into the internet money wallet and type in, I want to swap, 10,000 USDC for whatever, look at your output and then go to PulseX or any of the DEXs individually, especially if you see a small pool. If you see a small pool, type that in and then look at how staggering that difference can be with the DEX aggregator. And again, Piteas, those guys are awesome, but also if you're using internet money, it'll do it automatically for you. And that's a good example. So like, that's kind of like what I was talking about with Pineapple Love earlier. That's cool, right? Like that gives you some significance. If you got a no coin or a friend, be like, man, you can roll in a Lambo with this stuff. It's real, like it's tangible. So that's helpful, but it's not really going to be like hyper price positive. And it's not going to have the same kind of fungibility. So like the idea of trying to like turn one of these things into a currency is difficult, but having shops like this here, where you get something super baller and enjoyable and fun to be able to let those guys take it directly, that's pretty cool. So that's a great comment. Ink's the new meme token. It's pumping harder than everything else. Everybody's stupid. You should have bought Ink. Ink's interesting, man. So I default away from things like that. Not because Ink sucks. And this will be something that genuinely, like I'm negative EV on this. So like, I don't do meme coin stuff. I don't mess around too heavily with things. No, I've always had some portion of the bags there, but it's not something I'm going to be heavy on. And it's not because you can't make a ton of money on ink or the meme coin stuff, but there's two things. One is I like to play good games. And if you look at a meme coin chart that has 100X on it, when you're really looking at that, there's as much pain as there is positivity in those charts. And I just don't, they're not really good games, right? If you look at, say, Bitcoin, have people lost money in Bitcoin? Absolutely. People have been wrecked on Bitcoin? Absolutely. But if you look at it on the whole, it's a more plus EV game for more of the users, right? So the longer these things play out, the longer the Lindy effect, the more product market fit utility, they're going to work out better on average for more of the users. Now, again, I realize that means giving up on insane upside in crypto. Like that is, what would you say? That's my personal bit of like more life strategy than it is, hey, this is how to go make EV. If you go do the B roots thing, if you get meme coins right, there is no greater upside, period. There's no argument. So I think that's where meme coin and, you know, utility guys get crossways. If you figure it out and you don't get wrecked and you know what you're doing and you say, hey, I want to turn a dollar into a dollar, the meme coin stuff is going to hit hard. You got to get it right. You got to be early. You have to understand that game. It's higher, not necessarily higher volatility, but once it goes down, meme coins have less and less of a chance of coming back up again. But if you want pure X's and you're good at that game, that is going to be the highest upside, the highest return when you get that stuff right. If you take a player who's got 10 grand and they put $2,000 or $3,000 in the right meme coins, they get up, they get out, and they do it again and again, they will be up astronomical. That's just, I don't particularly like that kind of game mechanic. And then I'm also just not good at it. Part of it is that's just not my bag. That's not where I lean into. That's not where I'm going to be successful. So that's why you hear me be fair on meme coins, but it's not my game. I don't talk about them too much. Now with ink, what I was getting to before I got all sidetracked, ink is meme-ish, and that's kind of where I think RH is playing into. But Ink has some cool stuff with the MasterChef contract. There is some tokenomic effect to it. We could see it played out and be more and more impactful in the ecosystem. The other is, I think that we'll see Ink and PulseX specifically have more things built on top in the future. So we just saw Earn, for example, right? But when you look at, like, say airdrops. Why do people do airdrops? Like, work. They get people's attention. They're kind of leeching off of an existing brand that functions well. So Ink has a whole bunch of holders that would love something cool to happen with it. So this is what you see with like LL. LL built something cool. It's on top of PLS. There's a big audience. It functions well and it rocks and rolls. So I think that there's reasons to be bullish on Ink purely from a farm, MasterChef contract, whatever, you know, kind of stuff that the core dev team does. But just moving forward, if I was looking to build something interesting, depending on how it all functioned, it would make sense to build on top of Ink. You're going to like build in an audience right away. Like if somebody built something cool right now on Ink, everyone would know about it in a couple of weeks versus having to build something completely unique with a new token, sort of flush it all the way out and kind of get a user base up. So I think we'll see cool stuff with Ink sooner rather than later. I'm always going to be very, very conservative on pricing estimates. Again, naturally, that's a better bet. It's more sound, in my opinion. I'm also not trying to hit 10,000 X's. And I think that that's helped keep me out of a lot of rug pulls and bad decisions. Because if the mentality is like, if you're focused on like, hey, what'll give me a 10,000 X? It's easy to overlook red flags and just try to optimize for like, hey, how can I hit a 10,000X? Whereas if you just say, I want a very, very high percentage that I just end up positive, crypto positive is multiple Xs, right? Like if you go through the whole bull run for the next 18 months and all you got was a 5X, everybody would say you missed out. They would say you were dumb and terrible. There is some logic to what they're saying, that there's an opportunity cost. Got me personally, guys, like I'm fine with just taking a 5X. Like that's such a huge return relative to investment of time and what it would be in any other asset class. So I'm not trying to tell people to not go chase up extra gains or to not do, again, kind of goes back to that meme coin narrative. That's just not how I like to think about things. And it's kept me out of a lot of bad decisions. It's made me more focused and be a little more romantic with the tech. I tend to know more about the things that I touch. So again, I'm always going to be like, no, nothing 10,000X is, that's dumb. Doesn't mean things that can't. I just like to lean into, hey, I think this thing is going to be net positive. I think it's going to be up and to the right. I think the yield is going to play well. And I just let crypto do its thing. If I'm just guessing and I'm positive on most things, then that's going to work out well. And again, that's just what works out best for me from my own investment thesis. That's not something that we have planned right this second. The downloaded version is really helpful for probably guys like yourself with a name like Old Timer Computer. It is something that we could look at doing in the future. I think we're going to lean more toward just encouraging multiple front ends. So we already have our second one. Power City is going to have another one up at some point here pretty quick in the future. That would give us three. And there's at least two or three other teams that are still working on different ideas. The Hocus Pocus guys are also looking at some staking architecture that would go into the things they're building. So it wouldn't necessarily give you access to the vault side, but it would give you staking access and a few different things. So there's lots of teams that are working on basically that redundancy that you're looking for with the EXE file. It's still something we could possibly do if you really were super OG gangster about it. You could download the SDK and like set up like a very like almost command line prompt front end for yourself if you really got into it. But if you care that much, shoot me a DM. I'll be happy to kind of go back and forth and maybe we can work out something easier, especially if you just kind of like it for your own edification and like doing cool stuff. It is something, again, we could always do in the future. We'll definitely finish some of the stuff with making fetch public and that kind of cool thing. And then again, we'll lean on having multiple front ends. So again, naturally, anytime you're using any platform, the risk is the platform, right? So innately, you have to trust that we're not going to screw up things that you'll have, again, similar like Old Timer Computer asked, that you have access to front end. So if you kind of get away from, hey, this stuff works, now what are the concerns and risk of using it as a collateral? The risk are, the first part, just it's crypto. Shit just moves around fast, right? So that's the real concern is just that you have a relatively volatile asset. So we have to over collateralize in a way that's not, given that you said positive EV, I'm assuming that it's not capital efficient, right? So that's like fractional reserves. While we hate them in the way that they're applied today, they come somewhere for a reason, right? And it's to be capital efficient. So when you use something that's extremely volatile, you have to be less capitally efficient to basically take up the margin that thing moves around at. So the short answers are just, you have to trust the platform. You're using something that moves around a lot. And then you're also using a form of collateral that does not have that many people that find that collateral valuable, right? So if I collateralize property, again, there are certain places that property is less liquid, but like, let's say it's a condo in downtown London, everyone will come buy the stupid thing, right? It's a very liquid asset. There's a lot of people who accept that collateral. If it's gold, it's accepted around the world. With PLS, you constrain the number of users. So you sort of have some like meta economic stuff there, but particularly when it comes to using just LL, those are the main things. It's just that volatility. So the positive EV strategy really comes into what do you want to do next? And it comes from, again, increasing that, that efficiency in the market. So if I want to say collateralize and then take that USDL and then purchase more PLS, then I'm going to basically take a light form of leverage and allow myself to vary that position more carefully than I would traditional like longs and shorts. So the plus EV would be to increase the exposure to other risk on things that you want. So whether that's PulseX, Hex, any of these other things, it also allows you to maintain that full price exposure. And then what you are denominating your debt in is not risk on. So I hold something that's worth 100,000. I mint 15,000 worth of USDL. Pulse doubles. I still only own 15,000 USDL. So that's one of the advantages of using things like LL, and especially with 0%. So the plus EV really comes into what you do next, right? So just using it as collateral doesn't do anything, but what you do with that extra capital and where you move it around, whether it's something as simple as saying, hey, I'm going to put it in the stability pool, or again, maybe it's something like the Flux pools where you're in multiple stable coins and you have very little risk on exposure. Those are the things that are like the simple way. And then the most positive EV is, again, you get all the way to the end of you know, really pushing leverage on something or buying on things that have crazy upside, any of these other meme things. So, you know, I would lean in the middle. I lean towards saying, hey, I want, you know, very, very strong yield plays, and I want to increase my exposure to loan PLS, PLSX. So that's how I kind of view that thing. The flash crash, it gets a little tricky, and it's a little, it's one of those conversations that it's kind of hard to have on like this wide of a of an audience, because you don't want people to hear one part of this. But the flash crash is it's less of an issue than you initially think, and it becomes less of an issue the longer your play has played out for the most part. So let's say for example that I have you know, 100K in PLS. I took out 15K in USDL, and I'm generating yield at say 40%, whatever it is, right? If it flash crashes the second after I do that, it's going to come down, and I'm going to take that 10% loss on liquidation. And I haven't really made anything yet, and I basically sold there. So the worst case would be that it comes down, hits, I take that 10% loss on liquidation, and the price runs off. That would be kind of the worst case. But if that's, say, been going on for a year, 2 years, 3 years, again, I'm just using a long time frame for an example, then even if you go through and you finally do take that liquidation event, you've generated yield that whole time. So this is similar to like what we have going on with some redemptions right now. So while I've been kissed with redemptions a few times where I lost a little bit of a percentage as the price moves away from me afterwards, I've gained so much over this time frame because of extra loan payouts and of yield here and of LP providing an increased PLS experience, that it's still net super positive. So that's kind of where you get in like the flash crash. Part of it is just time in. So like if you're generating yield, the longer it goes out, the more at a loss you have to be to cover up that yield, similar like impermanent loss. And then the other part is, if this is your liquidation threshold, right, on price, and you get this huge drop that goes all the way down below it, and you get liquidated here, it works like an inefficient stop loss. So then you would be able to buy back in. So I knew I threw a lot at you, but I'm just trying to like almost like check this out, check this out, check this out, check this out. And then you can go through those things. So that's also something that would make for a great discussion in the Telegram, where people can more easily say, hey, hold on. Can we run through that again? And you can give a little more clarity. So like essentially the flash crash is less impactful than people think. But again, you don't want to just tell everybody, hey, liquidation is no problem, go leverage long and do all these things. It takes a little more of a nuance to make those things happen. But I love that type of discussion. It's a great question, brother. Where can I learn more about the liquidation mechanics? So you can pull them up. You can look at liquidations. They're in the DAP. There's a video there. Judging by the way that you speak, I would imagine that you probably just want to go and look at the documentation that we have right there on the site. It's very, very, very clean, that you can actually look through in the formula and the mechanics there, the reserve. I'd imagine you probably just want to dig through and get to the weeds there, but we also have a couple of blogs on them. So if you type liquidation and search that on the website and the blogs, it'll probably be really helpful.